Now on CBN News Tonight, the nation's highest court considers the cross. See why some want it removed from all government property. Plus, it's been 8 years since the start of the Afghan war. Where does the president stand on sending more troops? And the man who's taking on Oprah, a closer look at her spirituality. That and more right now on CBN News Tonight.
Thanks for joining us for CBN News Tonight. I'm Mark Martin. The Supreme Court is deciding the fate of an 8-foot wooden cross put up to honor veterans. Their ruling could impact religious displays across the country. The cross in question has stood on government property in the Mojave Desert for 75 years. CBN's Paul Strand spoke with both sides at today's Supreme Court hearing.
The cross at the heart of this case stands far out in the desert, covered in plywood. That's because lower courts worried the cross represents a government endorsement of religion.
In the Supreme Court, the justices seem leery of tackling the really big issues like separation of church and state, and whether the man who brought this suit even had standing to do so. Most of it revolved around procedural matters. But still, even out of that, could come a decision with huge implications.
The danger in this case is the precedent it could set. At the end of the day, to have a constitutional crisis over an 8-foot cross in the Mojave Desert sets up a really dangerous precedent.
Henry and Wanda Sandoz have been taking care of that cross for 25 years.
If they can take this one down, what's to stop them from taking any one that they want down?
Those for the cross remaining say that it's really not much more than a war memorial. But others argue that there's no way that a cross stands for all the war dead of America.
But my father is a Jewish war veteran. My grandfather was a Jewish war veteran in World War I. And to say that a cross represents the sacrifice of the 250,000 Jews who fought for this country in World War I is simply not true.
The cross in the Mojave Reserve has no historic significance. It has no secular significance. It is a powerful symbol of the predominant religion in this country. And as such, it has no business being in the Mojave Reserve.
The justices didn't seem at all unfriendly towards the cross. In fact, from the most conservative to the most liberal, they seemed to be looking for some way that the cross could remain standing.
This veteran said Justice Ginsburg seemed to embrace one novel solution.
Tear down the cross, transfer the land from government ownership to private ownership, and then re-erect the cross.
I think it's going to be close. I think that cross ends up staying at the end of the day.
Justice Scalia, one of the justices friendliest to religion, mentioned during the argument that the cross really is the most recognized symbol for the dead. And he asked opponents what they would have done. All the religious symbols put on the memorials? Then he said, that would be outrageous. Paul Strand, CBN News, reporting from the Supreme Court.
Congressman Randy Forbes is the chairman of the Congressional Prayer Caucus. He tells CBN News this case has huge national implications.
We are hopeful that the court will find that the cross stands, but there are just a couple points we need to make clear. The government has even offered and proposed actually to transfer this cross so it wouldn't be on government property. A lot of the lands in this reserve are actually private property. This would be owned by the veterans themselves, not the government, and still they're trying to take this cross down. And their argument is that just because one individual could drive by at some distance and be offended by it, that they ought to be able to rip it down. If we allow this case to stand and what the Ninth Circuit has done, then I think what you've heard some of the other people talk about, we're going to see crosses under attack in our cemeteries across the country and other places that the government and private individuals might have across the country.
We are in a battle, that is for sure. Well, today is the 8th anniversary of the U.S. war in Afghanistan, and President Obama marked the occasion by meeting with his military advisors. As John Waagi reports, the White House must soon decide on a strategy to win the war or get out.
It's a different world from the weeks after 9/11 when the U.S. first attacked al-Qaeda and the Taliban.
On my orders, the United States military has begun strikes against al-Qaeda terrorist training camps and military installations of the Taliban regime in Afghanistan.
8 years later, the Taliban is regaining strength despite a valiant military effort by U.S. and NATO service members. The military's top generals say they need as many as 40,000 more troops to build the Afghan security force in the next 2 years and protect the people from the Taliban. Retired General Jack Keane, an architect of the successful surge in Iraq, supports the generals.
Well, first of all, we need to stabilize Afghanistan, and we have a deteriorating situation right now because we have never applied the sufficient amount of resources since the priority became Iraq. Now we're able to shift our priorities to Afghanistan, put in play for the first time a counterinsurgency strategy which is designed to protect the people. And that requires more troops when you put that strategy in play.
Leading Republicans who met with President Obama Tuesday also support the general's plan. But many Democrats are restless about the war and want to wage it with fewer troops and more technology or get out altogether.
The president's going to make a decision, popular or unpopular, based on what he thinks is in the best interest of the country.
But with U.S. casualties in Afghanistan on the rise again, the decision won't be made without testing the political winds and gauging the mood of Americans who aren't excited about a war that seems destined to last a decade or more. John Waggy, CBN News.
In other news, the much-anticipated price tag for the Senate Finance Committee's version of the health care bill is in. The nonpartisan Congressional Budget Office says the bill will cost $829 billion in the next 10 years, a figure that comes in under President Obama's $900 billion limit. The Budget Office also predicts the bill will reduce the federal deficit by $81 billion in the next 10 years. But Republicans argue the bill has too many new taxes. Congressional tax experts say the bill will require healthcare industries to pay about $100 billion in extra taxes. Today's report paves the way for the committee to vote on the bill as early as Friday. John Jessup is in Washington with more on today's report from the Congressional Budget Office.
Well, if you thought the heavy lifting came when the Senate Finance Committee debated the bill, think again. Now that the bill has a new price tag to go along with all those amendments attached during the past 2 weeks of debate, it goes back to the full committee for vote. And you can bet that it will fall pretty much along party lines, especially after the so-called Group of Six failed to reach an agreement on a bipartisan bill. Now, after the vote, the bill must be merged with another version that passed in another Senate committee in July. And there are major differences between those bills, namely the creation of a public insurance option. It is included in the bill that passed earlier this summer, but it's not in the Senate Finance Committee's version. Politico.com is already reporting that lawmakers are angling for a seat at the table to combine the two bills, but Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid wants to limit the number of people negotiating. That way he can keep pace with getting a bill to the full Senate for debate, possibly as early as next week, and get final legislation to the president by Thanksgiving. That's still no easy task. There are three committees in the House that have their own health care bills that need to be combined into one and later merged with whatever comes out of the Senate. I'm John Jessup reporting in Washington. Now back to you.
The federal budget deficit has tripled and hit a record $1.4 trillion for 2009. Congressional analysts point to a big drop in tax revenue as one of the causes. And the $245 billion spent in bailing out Wall Street and the mortgage giants. They also note President Obama's $200 billion stimulus bill. The previous record deficit was $459 billion, and that was set last year. The first wave of the H1N1 flu vaccine is crossing the country this week, and so is something else, fear. Not only fear of the virus, but fear of the vaccine. An Associated Press poll shows more than a third of parents don't want their kids to be vaccinated. Some people think the vaccine is risky, but federal health officials are pushing it, saying they will be tracking side effects.
One wonders whether there's such a rush to administer a vaccine that has yet to prove its efficacy.
Taking the chance that you or your roommate or your child may be one of those maybe rare but serious cases, may have an underlying impact, may expose someone else.
The government says the swine flu vaccine is made the same way as the seasonal flu vaccine, and so far no scary side effects have shown up in tests, including tests on children. This is not the first time in our nation's history fears from a swine flu vaccine have brought on debate. Dale Hurd takes a look back at the swine flu outbreak of 1976.
33 years ago, swine flu caused a nationwide panic and may have helped bring down a president,
killing David Lewis, a 20-year-old recruit.
February 1976 is when that recruit died. The next month, President Gerald Ford, fearing an outbreak, issued a dire warning.
We cannot afford to take a chance with the health of our nation.
This is a most difficult decision that has an aspect of you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't.
So they started what some felt was an ominous nationwide vaccination PR blitz.
Get a shot of protection, the swine flu shot.
Some 40 million Americans stood in long lines for their shot, but from the beginning, the public and the media questioned it.
The controversy over whether it's really needed has still not been resolved.
That's because as the weeks unfolded, that pandemic they'd been expecting never happened. The vaccination effort soon became a public relations nightmare for President Ford.
Now come more reports today of a number of deaths around the country.
To prove the shot was safe, the president was inoculated in the basement of the White House.
It's all done?
All set.
He didn't win.
No,
didn't even know it.
His opponent in that year's election did not.
In Syracuse today, Jimmy Carter said he is not going to take a shot, is not afraid of it, but doesn't want to influence others by his decision.
And he wasn't alone.
Empty, deserted, and it will stay that way for the next month, if not longer. In fact, the top medical experts we've spoken to dejectedly declare that barring a major swine flu epidemic in the next several weeks, this is the end of the swine flu program.
By the time it was over, the head of the Centers for Disease Control was out of a job, and there was a public backlash against flu shots. Dale Hurd, CBN News.
A new Justice Department survey finds the majority of children are exposed to some sort of violence in their daily lives. The report is based on phone calls made to over 4,000 school-aged children. The survey shows that over 60% of kids were exposed to violence over the past year. Nearly 1 in 10 kids say they saw a family member assault another family member. 57% say they were themselves assaulted. And 6% of all the kids surveyed say they were themselves sexually victimized. Attorney General Eric Holder says these numbers are unacceptable.
We simply cannot stand for an epidemic of violence that robs our youth of their childhood and perpetuates a cycle in which too many of today's victims become tomorrow's criminals.
Holder was in Chicago meeting with parents and students about last month's vicious beating that killed a 16-year-old high school student. Dozens of identity thieves are behind bars tonight after stealing thousands of email passwords. The FBI made the arrest this morning in Southern California, Nevada, and North Carolina. About 100 arrests are expected to be made in the U.S. and Egypt. The identity thieves stole the passwords through a method called phishing, which involves leading people to give personal info to fake websites. The victims of the schemes lost a combined $2 million.
Still to come on CBN News tonight, taking on Oprah, a look at her spirituality and what Christians may not know about it. Plus, our must-see video of the day, one government's plan to hold cabinet meetings under the sea.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart.
These are the most powerful songs of our time. And now, for the first time, the biggest praise and worship songs are together.
How great is our God.
Presenting Songs for Worship 50. 50 songs in one specially priced collection.
Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled.
You'll hear 50 beautiful songs of hope.
I'm coming back to the heart of worship. And it's
50 powerful songs of faith. Get Songs for Worship 50 on three CDs for only
$24.99. Here I am for worship. Here I am.
But wait, order in the next 10 minutes with your credit card and we'll take $15 off. That's right. You get 50 praise and worship songs for just
$9.99.
Then preview other great praise and worship collections. Satisfaction guaranteed.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
So call now and get Songs for Worship 50. 50 beautiful songs on three CDs for just
$9.99.
Call 1-800-435-3414 to order Songs for Worship 50 on three CDs for $9.99 plus shipping and handling when you use your credit card. Call now or order online at timelife.com/songsforworship50.
You're watching CBN News Channel with Mark Martin and Wendy Griffith.
Welcome back. Thousands of Israeli police are on guard in Jerusalem to control violence at the Temple Mount. Arabs rioted for three straight days during the Jewish holiday of Sukkot. The riots are fueled by rumors that Jews are trying to undermine the foundation of the Al-Aqsa Mosque. The mosque is next to the Jews' holiest site, the Western Wall. Police and border guards Tuesday arrested Muslim Sheikh Raed Salah for stirring up the trouble. He was released but banned from Jerusalem for 30 days. Salah had called for Muslims to defend the mosque with their bodies. Two major earthquakes have hit in the Pacific Ocean, and a tsunami warning has been issued for most parts of the Pacific. The first earthquake hit near the Philippines, then an 8.1 magnitude quake hit near the Santa Cruz Islands. So far, no reports of damage or injuries, and no tsunami warnings have been issued for the U.S. West Coast. Today, thousands of villagers started returning home following the floods in South India. The floods started receding over the weekend, and now villagers are finally returning to assess damages to their homes and farmland. The floods are described as the worst in decades. They killed more than 269 people and left more than 2 million more homeless. Many families are still living in temporary homes set on roadsides. Their governments are currently working on sending medical aid to the villagers to prevent disease from spreading. And in Indonesia, nearly 90,000 homes were destroyed or severely damaged in last week's earthquake. Entire villages were wiped out by landslides, with thousands homeless and needing food. Operation Blessing rushed to the scene to help the survivors. Many of them are still hoping to find their missing loved ones.
Yuhelmi believes her 13-year-old daughter is still here, buried under the rubble of the school. Days after a powerful earthquake shook this place, Yuhelmi and her relatives are hoping against all hope that rescue teams will find Yosa.
My heart is so broken. She's my only daughter from all my children. My feeling is almost indescribable. Or maybe, like this rumble in front of me is what my heart is like now. I will stay here. I won't go until my daughter is found.
Yuhelmi is not alone. Across this area, families are still searching for loved ones amidst the death and destruction. More than 1,000 people have died, but thousands more are thought to be missing after a massive 7.6 magnitude quake struck the Indonesian island of Sumatera a week ago today. This is what remains of a three-star hotel in Padang. The hotel was full of guests attending seminars the day the quake struck. Septenang was fortunate to make it out.
Because we never expected that a disaster would happen, now I am grieving over the loss of my friends. I am so sad. I felt the bonding already happened among all of us. On the second day of the seminar, the atmosphere was full of happiness. We felt the closeness.
The city of Padang is slowly coming back to life, but the situation is more dire in many of the remote villages. The epicenter of this devastating quake lies 60 kilometers north of Padang, in Paramon, where hundreds of villages lie in ruins, and hundreds of families now live or sleep outdoors with no place to go. And it is here that Operation Blessing has come. Thousands of food packages to help families to make it to the next week are pouring in, as well as blankets, tents, and emergency medical treatment. Labai Suri, an Islamic teacher, lost six members of his family. The bodies of three of them had been found, and he took us to a small mosque where they were waiting for proper burial. Because he no longer has many relatives who are able to take care of him, Operation Blessing gave him medical treatment and provided him with food and shelter. Just one of the many victims, Operation Blessing is here to help.
You can learn more about Operation Blessing's disaster relief efforts at our website, cbnnews.com. Up next tonight, she's one of the most influential women in the world. See the Christian response to Oprah's spirituality.
Each week, thousands of concerned parents and grandparents start Globe Young American plans for their children and grandchildren. The Young American plan is a simple, affordable way to secure valuable life insurance protection. Starting a Young American plan today guarantees the future insurability of your loved ones. Once issued, the Young American plan can never be canceled. For just $1, you can start a Young American plan and feel safe knowing you've provided your child or grandchild with a lifetime of protection. The regular premium you establish now is guaranteed to never increase. And the Young American plan builds cash value that can be used in the future. Since 1964, millions of concerned parents and grandparents have started Globe Young American plans for their children and grandchildren. Call Globe today.
Call right now for complete information about the Globe Young American plan. Call Globe today at 1-800-457-4154.
Oprah Winfrey, her name is known around the world, and without a doubt, she carries tremendous influence in our culture today. Christian apologist, author, and speaker Josh McDowell has co-authored a book that will soon have people talking about the talk show queen. It's called Oh God, A Dialogue on Truth and Oprah's Spirituality. And Josh joins us now to talk about Oh God, which hits bookstores today. Welcome, Josh. Thanks for joining us.
Well, it is good to be here with you.
First of all, this book probably won't win you and your co-author, Dave Sterrett, any popularity contests. So what compelled you to write it?
Well, you know, in many ways, I think it will help with a popularity contest in this sense. We wrote it because we respect Oprah. I think she's a great woman. I wish more Christians had the passion as she has for orphans and kids being educated in Africa. But what concerns me are her teachings and the people she brings around her, which I think theologically and personally are devastating.
Now, it is a fictional conversation between two women. Explain this approach.
Well, it's not so much a fictional conversation. It's a real life dialogue between two young ladies and one who has become a believer out of Hinduism and another who is divorced and a lawyer. And working on towards being a lawyer. And as you listen to their dialogue, you read it, I guarantee you the reader is going to start feeling, wow, I didn't know that's what that meant. Because most people today don't know what some of this terminology and everything that's going around even means.
Josh, what do you hope to achieve through the book?
Well, I hope to achieve, first of all, with believers, that will cause believers to question not so much what they believe, but why they believe it, and will motivate them to do their homework, to know more why what they believe. You see, Oprah is not teaching anything new or different than what has been around for years, but because she's a phenomenal personality and the position, the platform she has, then as a result, she's having a greater impact on how people believe than even many of our major churches today. And to show you that influence, when America was attacked the first time in Pearl Harbor, the memorial for that was held at the National Cathedral in Washington, D.C., conducted by the Episcopal clergy. When the second time America was hit, which was 9/11, now think of this, it was held at Yankee Stadium, arranged and conducted by Oprah Winfrey. That shows the power of this woman.
But obviously you have some concerns with the quote-unquote theology that she espouses through her show. Can you talk about that?
Much of what she propagates is a result of other authors like Eckhart Tolle. And she'll say, well, you need to find the Christ consciousness within you. Look deep down within you and find that Christ consciousness and live out your inklings, your desires. If you don't, then you are inauthentic. An example, when she was interviewing Ted Haggard after it came out about his homosexual affair, etc., he and his wife were on her program. And it was really a good interview until it came to this. And it was still a good interview. His wife interrupted Ted and said that ever since Ted was a small boy, a young man, he has struggled with these homosexual desires, and he's trying everything he can to bring them under control. Oprah stood up and said, that is where I disagree with you. She said, you need to live out those desires. You need to let those desires permeate your life. Otherwise, you're not authentic. And I'm sitting there saying, well, what if he was a child abuser? What if he was a rapist? Would you say the same thing? Well, you know, in the scriptures, we are commanded in 2 Corinthians 13:5, examine yourself, whether Christ be in you or you be reprobate. Now, it doesn't mean to find the Christ consciousness. What it's saying is when a person trusts Christ as Savior and Lord, then God, the Holy Spirit, enters that person's life and Christ takes up his abode within our lives through the Holy Spirit.
All right, Josh McDowell, thanks for your time, and we're looking forward to seeing how God uses this book in the lives of many people. Thanks again, Josh. Take care.
God bless.
And when we come back, our must-see video of the day.
Introducing Easy Combs, the easy new way to create dazzling new dos. Simply slide in one end, stretch it around your hair, and slide in on the other side for an updo that's brand new. Or fluff it out for a fountain effect. Look again. The bungee band stretch and release for a relaxed custom fit every time. Liven up a ponytail or create this amazing butterfly twist. It's great for short hair and ideal for the office. It's perfect for any formal occasion. Ouch, claw clips hurt. But Easy Combs are soft and comfortable, so easy to use, kids love them too. Now get Easy Combs in caramel bronze for only $10. Call now and get one in dazzling silver. As a special bonus, get our Bermuda black plus a styling DVD. Just pay separate shipping and handling. With the step-by-step DVD, Easy Combs are a cinch. You get caramel, silver, and black plus the style guide and DVD, a $60 value, all for only $10.
Call 1-800-520-1486. You'll get the bonus Easy Combs as advertised when you call 1-800-520-1486.
Love to shop for shoes, but there's no place to store them? You're always running out of room to store more. Introducing Shoes Under, the easy solution to organize and protect your shoes. The clear zipper cover locks out dust and moisture. Now you just slide and store. It's that easy. With two handles, you can easily store your shoes here, under there, almost everywhere, and turn an empty space into a super storage place. Other shoe organizers can cost a fortune, but through this exclusive television offer, you can get the 12-compartment Shoes Under for only $19.99. Call now and we'll cut that price in half. That's right, for only $10. And as a bonus, we'll double the offer and give you a second Shoes Under that's enough space for 48 shoes. Just pay separate shipping and handling. Call now and get two Shoes Under for only $10.
Call 1-800-943-1652. You'll get a second one free, so call 1-800-943-1652. That's 1-800-943-1652. Call now.
Finally tonight, our must-see video of the day.
Our first must-see video comes from Charleston, South Carolina, where thousands of students are taking part in the International Walk to School Day. Over 61,000 students from over 120 schools across the state participated. It's an effort to create safer ways for kids to walk and ride their bikes to school. Next, we head to Capitol Hill, where this bronze statue of Helen Keller was unveiled in Statuary Hall. It shows the blind and deaf Alabama girl at a water pump. That's the moment she learned to communicate without sight or hearing. The statue is the first in the Capitol to honor a child and a disabled person. And finally, we go to Colombo, Sri Lanka, where Maldives government ministers are preparing for a meeting at the bottom of the ocean. They're taking scuba lessons and learning underwater signs. The meeting will be on October 17th, and it's intended to highlight the threat that they believe global warming has on their nation. And that's tonight's must-see video.
And I wonder who's paying for that little demonstration under the sea. Probably taxpayers. Well, that's all for this edition of CBN News Tonight. But remember, you can follow us anytime online at cbnnews.com and on our Twitter page at Twitter/CBN News. Thanks for watching once again. Have a great night.